lifetime achievement winners. It's amazing. I've never had that experience before. And you know, Dick has never been off duty. He is always advocating for Fulbright program. I remember he called me one day when we were at a conference in London. He said, "We're going to have time for our maybe a glass of wine after a while." You remember? And he caught me and he said, "This is a serious issue. The funding for the Fulbright program is at risk." He said the same thing every year since then. It's been riskier every year, he's right. It is with great respect and affection that I offer you these symbols of a lifetime achievement award to you, Richard Arndt.
Thank you. doesn't do the index of the document, she can put it over here. That's first, you can see it over there, I don't see what I can do. That's the easy part, I know it all by heart. But the next person I think I have to fight, which is fast, is a man who's long gone. And I think we owe every person in this room owes a debt to a man named James Lee Floyd. I knew him pretty well, I would say very well, pretty well. He told me a lot of very funny things, sometimes repeating, sometimes I won't tonight. But one thing that he did say about himself once, he said that he got his Rhodes scholarship on a fluke. And he then went on to say, after all, Dick, he said, I was just a country hick. That's all I was, a provincial kid. That's the way he thought. And so he felt very much that he, Arndt, saw Northwest Quine, had come all the way to Oxford, spent 4 years there, 2 years in college, and then 2 years moving around Europe on the Oxford program to learn to meet with most of the European leaders in the company of Mike Foley, or the great Hungarian journalist at the time. But he came back and decided that instead of just saying, I don't go to school, it'll be, that he was going to do what he could to make the Rhodes experience available to every American for a small time. And that's what he did. He did it by chicanery, by the most extreme enjoyment and ingenuity. He got it through by proving that it wouldn't cost the Congress anything, because it was all jumbles were in the Soviet Europe anyway, and so forth. And he did all of this, and for years he kept it going, and kept it going. What did that program do? It internationalized American education. It virtually created a whole new dimension in the American universities. It brought a whole bunch of new people to understand how our country and us to understand other countries. And to understand that civility and trust in humanity is what binds us human beings. The phrase we use about the senator most often is a vast cliche that I hate to use, but I'll say it anyway. Mutual understanding. When you think about understanding each other both ways, that's what he was about. So we must thank the senator, you've already done it. There's another thing that I would like to say, and that is that everybody in this room has been blessed, pretty much everybody, by a Fulbright grant, a Fulbright experience. And we've all said in one way or another that it changed our lives. Some of us can't quite remember how it changed. Here we all are, and I would say I've been proud by you through Nancy Neal and the board and all your tentacles for our association has throughout this country and throughout the rest of the world. In fact, I owe my Mexico thanks to all of you, fellow Fulbrighters and historical artists, meet you now more than ever.
Help save
comments from people on the 70th anniversary that before we get to the 71st, we should have get about maybe up to 40,000 members. So we'll take that on as a challenge. I will endure it very much. Okay? Awesome.
Well, I would like to say that I've been wandering on through life.
and hungry. That's what happens. So,
I'm here.